Peter Schiff, in the impending collapse, everything that can go wrong, will. The impending economic collapse is hidden from most. People only see a rising stock market, not the negative underlying factors that will cause the whole system to crash. The weakening of the US dollar is just getting started, warned veteran market forecaster Peter Schiff, CEO of Euro-Pacific Capital. We have just begun a major, long-term bear market in the dollar, he said, which should cause a spike in oil prices. He thinks oil will reach $80 minus $100 a barrel in 2018. The commodity currently trades at roughly $63 a barrel. Schiff focuses on oil as just one example of the inflation that will help collapse the dollar. Will the US dollar collapse in 2018? The US currency, relative to its competitors, is not as strong as many would like to think. Amid a series of expected interest rate hikes in the Eurozone and at the Bank of England, backed by actual economic growth, currency investors should pay attention in the coming year. It's really time to start wondering, will the US dollar collapse in 2018? Consider the US dollar index's long-term prospects, as illustrated in the chart below. It will not tell you exactly when the dollar crash will happen. But, given that the index compares the US currency's performance relative to other major currencies, it offers some sobering perspective. It's no secret that, over the course of the past three decades or so, the US dollar has dropped by some 25%, compared to its rivals in the currency markets. And now, the dollar is about to collapse. Is the US dollar going to collapse in 2018? Whether by design, President Donald Trump claims he wants a low dollar, or by accident, the US dollar index has lost about 10% in 2017. This trend can only continue and likely accelerate in 2018. The US dollar is paying, and will continue to pay, because of the inaction over the economy in Washington. The gamblers might bet on the dollar going up, but the wise will be the ones paying attention to US dollar collapse predictions. Much of Trump's economic strategy and recovery plan hinge on the passing of his fiscal reform. However, it's too radical and may even be too unrealistic. As presented to Congress, loaded with major tax cuts for corporations and for private individuals alike, in theory it could help stimulate growth and raise the standard of living for everybody. The logic of Trump's tax reform is that the tide lifts all boats. It's another interpretation of the trickle-down economics that President Ronald Reagan made popular in his first term, 1981 to 1985. But, as that plan proved, it's really only good for a few, and it produces huge debt. It's one of the reasons that the US dollar has lost so much strength over the past 30 to 40 years. One of the big pillars of Trump's economic reform is the tax reform. It's one of the most ambitious fiscal reforms to date, bigger even than what Reagan did in the 1980s. But there are many doubts about its viability. Perhaps Trump, or more likely the Republicans in Congress, will have to revise the plan and dilute its provisions. According to rumors, there has been pressure to shave off one of the primary components of the tax bill. This is the one that would lower corporate taxes to 20%. At best, that will have to be postponed. While the US has a relatively higher corporate tax rate than many of its industrialized competitors, it also allows for more numerous and generous tax deductions. Similarly, there's the ever-present perception and suspicion that the richest Americans are still going to end up as the biggest beneficiaries of the tax reform. As political tensions rise internationally and domestically, President Trump can't seem to make a single favorable move in the eyes of Democrats, meaning he could be a sitting duck. His opponents in Congress and there's plenty of bipartisan opposition to go around will weaken the White House politically, resulting in a diluted tax bill, regardless of what else happens. The yuan. Before any discussion over the weakness of the US economy, and if you doubt that, just look at the number of small and large-sized retail chains collapsing, it's worth noting the effect of the Chinese yuan. The more international currencies there are, the more the dollar faces competition. The value of an international currency like the dollar derives not only from interest rates and pure economic strength. Like gold, there is a strong element of perception. The dollar's strength, especially since the end of World War II, has been tied to US economic strength and political stability. but it has also been tied to U.S. military might. Now, the world seems ready to shift toward a world where the U.S. is no longer the only hegemony on the bloc. After the collapse of the Soviet Empire in 1990, the United States made the mistake of believing it was the only superpower. The mistake was good at first, helping speed up the transfer of technology from the military to the civilian realm. Few remember that the internet and email were first used by the military. Raytheon Company worked on the related infrastructure and basic idea of a connected information storage and access system in the late 1960s. The apparent victory of the American system over the Soviet one eased security considerations and, by 1995, many people were using the internet. By 2000, there were few people left in the world that were not using the internet. American businesses and finance benefited tremendously from the emergence of the so-called tech sector. It became, and still remains, the main growth generator in the American economy. But how long can America's dominance last? China's closing in. Fast. China is catching up quickly in every field of technology. Meanwhile, more and more American companies have moved their manufacturing to China already. Moreover, the Chinese are also expanding their military capabilities, building their own military vessels, stealth fighter jets, and smart weapons. They're even planning a space mission to the moon. China's international influence is rising in conjunction with its technology and military capacity. Part of that growing influence includes the yuan. China's currency is growing in importance. The International Monetary Fund, IMF, recently included it as a special drawing rights currency. Therefore, many central banks around the world are buying the yuan, with central banks reported having accumulated holdings valued at over $90 billion at the end of 2016. Just 6 months later, those same central banks held just short of $100 billion. Internationally, and even in the domestic U.S., there is uncertainty that the yuan can continue to rise at this unexpectedly rapid pace. Apart from the shift or erosion of American influence, the United States has built up a considerable but unfortunate phenomenon, debt. U.S. debt keeps growing larger and Trump's aforementioned fiscal policies could accelerate the rise of debt rather than slow it down. Trump's plan risks pushing debt higher, well beyond the current $20 trillion. Therefore, the Federal Reserve will be unable to raise interest rates. Similarly, other governments will want to diversify their monetary reserves, accumulating currencies that are not the U.S. dollar. China, of course, is one of these key players. The Bank of China alone holds about $1 trillion, and it has announced its intention to divest part of its U.S. dollar reserve. It plans to do this by using gold-backed future contracts and pricing oil in yuan. After taking concrete steps to dethrone the U.S. as the top tech power, China is closing in on the dollar. Higher interest rates will explode the market. Trump has chosen Jerome Powell to succeed Janet Yellen as chairperson of the Federal Reserve. Powell is not a fan of raising rates. He may be even less inclined than the outgoing Yellen. Should any Fed chair raise interest rates while U.S. debt keeps growing, the U.S. government will struggle even to pay back interest on the debt. At the current low level, the interest owed is more than $270 billion. With rates at a more normal, or historical, level, the interest alone could top $1 trillion. For various reasons, quantitative easing, QE, will therefore have to continue. American consumers, many of whom are struggling to cope with one form of debt or another, would get an increased perception of wealth with interest rates kept low. Higher rates would mean much higher interest on car loans, student loans, and mortgages. The U.S. comes closer to recession with every interest rate hike. Higher interest hurts the ability to borrow, which could prompt a recession. Trump has enough problems to worry about without adding that one to the list. Investors don't seem to be paying much attention to the value of stocks, much less the U.S. dollar. But they are wrong. The stock markets long ago passed the point of irrational exuberance. They are now entering downright spooky territory, and the level of risk is massive. Any unexpected economic move, such as an interest rate hike, could now be the proverbial drop that spills the cup. Raising interest rates is the main way to help the dollar sustain its value against major currencies, especially since many central banks, such as the European Central Bank and the Bank of England, have hinted that they're ready to adopt a tighter monetary policy. Investors are hungry for outperformance in the markets. They've been getting it, yet that only makes the inevitable collapse harder. Trump will exercise more influence than other recent presidents over monetary policy. He will be careful to let interest move much higher to prevent a crack on Wall Street. That will eventually start pushing against the rise of the dollar. When the price of oil rises, it reverberates through the economy. Peter called it a gigantic tax hike for consumers. But the Fed is still worried prices aren't going up fast enough and that they won't hit the mystical 2% goal. They're going to hit that out of the park. They're going to be looking at 2% in the rearview mirror, in the distant rearview mirror. That is going to be the big story. They're going to way overshoot and they're not going to be able to do anything about it. Peter Schiff also warns that the dollar's decline is just getting starting. He also says, everything that can go wrong, will. We are not experiencing economic growth. We are experiencing inflation. High inflation is not good for the dollar. By definition, high inflation means the dollar is losing purchasing power. If the dollar is losing purchasing power, that is bad for the dollar, Schiff explains. If they, the public and investors, don't think there's going to be inflation, they're wrong. Those expectations are totally wrong. People are ignoring what is going on in the currency market, what's going on in the commodities markets, what's going on in the bond markets. All of this stuff is flashing inflation, at least the way you measure it, consumer prices. Will the US economy collapse in 2018? Schiff continues with even more dire news. We are very close to a major breakdown in the bond market. Now, I know the bond market has dodged a lot of bullets. So you could say, Korean wolf. Look how long the bond market has held in there. But you know what? It's gonna hold up until it doesn't. And when it breaks, this bond market is gonna unravel. The whole thing could unravel very, very quickly. This is what is so dangerous here. You have the bond market potentially about to break down, a major 30-year bull market about to unravel, you have the dollar getting ready to go over the edge of a cliff. Schiff also warns to not put your trust in the government or their bonds. Everybody believes the Fed is going to shrink its balance sheet. Now, I don't believe that, but the markets believe it. Now, I checked the balance sheet on Thursday again. So far, it hasn't shrunk at all. So there's been no tapering. The risk of a big drop in the bond market has never been this high. And what happens if the bond market tanks? That's it. The stock market is gonna crash. There's a massive crash coming. And if the Fed is gonna panic, they're gonna try to stop it. The Feds will try to fix a stock market crash by not raising rates, which will lead to the imploding of the dollar. Everything that can go wrong, will. How close are we to the next US economic collapse in 2018? The answer to this question is that we could be quite close. The stock markets are trading at all-time highs, we have large debts outstanding by both the federal government and individual Americans, and there is a lot of uncertainty about President Trump and his administrative team. We tend to always look at how the past has turned out and never look towards the future. For instance, if the present is going well, then we assume that this trend will continue. If we come out of an economic collapse, then there is a buildup of fear that it may happen again. Why not look at the past, present, and future together to determine whether a financial crisis will occur and proactively be ready? Taking time to do this now will come with great benefits such as protecting your investment portfolio, managing any debts outstanding, knowing where to look for employment opportunities, or knowing where to start a new business venture. By having more knowledge, a more informed decision can be made. Today, this article will go through 5 signs of a US economic collapse in 2018. Number 1. Growing government debt. As of October 31, 2017, the amount of debt is approximately $20.4 trillion. Of course, the goal is to lower that debt from its current balance. However, in 2018, experts predict the overall federal debt will climb to $24.1 trillion. This seems to be the case for the next few years, with debt just piling up with no repayment plans. Having debt is not always a bad thing in order to grow an economy or invest in the future, but it does need to be paid down at the end of the day. As debt continues to grow, it limits future possible economic growth. One thing is for sure. If the economy slows down, it could also dry up government spending because of having limits on capital. For instance, when an economy slows, the government normally comes in and starts spending to get the ball rolling. This would include infrastructure, giving tax credits, and rebates. With a large amount of debt held, the federal government may have its hands tied and may not be able to do the things it does to drive up the economy. Due to the large amount debt held, there are huge interest payments that must be made, which does not help the economy in any way. It is great for investors that have invested in the debt instruments, because it contributes to their wealth. However, a large portion of the federal debt is held by foreign countries such as China and Japan. This benefits the Japanese and Chinese economies. This, therefore, leads to money leaving the US and has no contribution to America's growth. Number 2, stock markets trading at all-time highs. The year 2017 was quite a weird year in the stock markets in the US. It seems that almost every week, the market made a new all-time high. For example, in January, the S&P 500 index was trading at approximately 2,125 points. At the end of October, the index was trading at approximately 2,575 points. In this time period, it would calculate to a 21% gain or 450 points. The Dow Jones Industrial Average, DIA, saw a return of 17% over the same period. This is an index that only has blue-chip large-cap companies. Huge double-digit returns are not normal. A major reason why the markets were trading higher in 2017 was because of everything that President Trump promised during his campaign trail. This would include lower taxes on earned income and tax holidays for companies. It has been a year with Donald Trump as the president and nothing has come to fruition. The tax holidays were supposed to bring billions of dollars from foreign countries into the US, which should have resulted in more corporate spending and hiring. There have been rumors of this tax holiday still occurring, but a higher tax rate would be applied. This is one of the reasons why companies are trading higher compared to just 10 months ago. Another reason why the markets are trading higher is because income investors have no choice, resulting in investors taking on more investment risk. This is the case because the money market, savings accounts, and certificates of deposit, CDs, are offering rates that are near zero and below the inflation rate. Therefore, rather than parking money into an investment that pays no returns, investors are taking on more risk through the stock market. This includes retirees, pension plans, and wealthy individuals. Also, the markets are continuing to trade higher and investors don't want to miss out on the bullish run. Investment decisions without any research lead to markets being overvalued in stock market bubbles. Evidence of this style of investing is seen in the price-to-earnings P/E ratio. At the end of October of 2017, the P/E was 25.6 times. This would compare to a 5-year average P/E ratio of 15.2 times. This would amount to a 68% premium valuation compared to the present P/E ratio. Even when considering a 20-year P/E ratio, there is currently a 48% P/E trading valuation. The markets are quite toppy and it is one warning signal. Number 3, the unemployment rate. Since the last recession in 2008, the unemployment rate has improved dramatically. For instance, in September of 2009, the unemployment rate was 9.8%. In September of 2017, it is 4.2%. Of course, this is great, because it means a smaller percentage of individuals are unemployed. However, when digging into the number, there are a few misconceptions. The first being the percentage of individuals not looking for work. Back in September of 2009, the number of eligible workers looking for work was 65.1%. In September 2017, the participation rate has dropped to 63.1%. Having a lower participation rate means that fewer individuals are looking for work and will not contribute to the economy. individuals stop looking for employment due to sickness or disabilities, structural change occurring in the employment picture, becoming a full-time student, or early retirement. All these factors actually influence the U.S. economy in a negative manner, because companies will not be hiring the best talent. For example, when a company looks to hire and is taking in candidates' resumes, the best of best won't always be applying. If an individual is getting educated, it means there's a possibility of obtaining skills in a profession that needs fewer skills than previous experiences. Also, when someone becomes discouraged and is having a hard time finding work, the bird-in-hand scenario could be looked at. This simply means that people will take the first or second job offered rather than looking for something more suitable. This would occur because the fear of not finding any work is strongly considered. This is one indicator that puts a damper on economic growth. Number 4. Unstable government. During the campaign trail, Trump promised so much to the people of America, such as tax cuts, corporate tax cuts, a better healthcare system, less wasteful spending in the administration, and much more. It seems that President Trump spends more of his time on his Twitter account starting feuds rather than doing his tasks as intended as the President of the United States. Yes, some of the things Trump promised have seen follow through, such as less wasteful spending in the federal government. In some cases, his team members earn no salary, such as his daughter, Ivanka Trump, his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, and Reed Cornish, assistant to the President for Intergovernmental and Technology Initiatives. However, even though there are savings for three individuals under the Trump administrative, he is spending in other areas such as security for him and his family. This would include visiting his home in New York or golfing on the weekend in Florida. Another reason why Trump could cause the economy to collapse in 2018 is because of the instability of him and his team. There have been a number of people that have joined and already left the Trump administrative team. This has occurred because Trump doesn't get along with the individuals, or there has been some wrongdoing that has occurred. There are countless numbers of actions taken by Trump to show the markets and investors this instability. One example is the tense relationship between Rex Tillerson, the Secretary of State, and Trump. It was like the two were arguing like children in grade school. In the end, nothing really major happened due to Vice President Mike Pence intervening. Just weeks after the tension with Tillerson and Trump, Paul Manafort surrendered to the FBI relating to the conspiracy against the United States. Manafort was the former campaign manager of Donald Trump. The charges are related to the involvement of Russia in the 2016 United States presidential election. There are also charges related to money laundering. This could lead to a couple of things, with more individuals being involved in this wrongdoing, including people from Trump's team. Or Trump himself could be linked to having his hand in the interference of the election in 2016. There are so many unknown questions, which is not great for the markets and investors. The reason why this is one of the reasons for a U.S. economic collapse in 2018 is because it is proven that markets fall when there is uncertainty in the government. One example is when the Spain-Catalan dispute occurred, the markets fell quickly. The major financial institution saw losses greater than 5% in one day. This is one reason for seeing the U.S. financial crisis in 2018. Number 5. Rising national debt. As of June 30, 2017, the total amount of household debt was $12.8 trillion. This was an increase of $114 billion from the previous three-month period. On a comparable basis, the $12.8 trillion debt is 15.1% higher than what it was in 2013 and higher than its peak in 2008 by $164 billion. This happens to be right before the financial crash, which saw many Americans suffering financially. The largest portion of the debt being held is mortgages balances. This component accounts for $8.6 trillion, which is 67% of the total debt. Balances on home equity lines of credit, HELOC, was standing at $452 billion. Also, credit card and auto loans saw an increase of 2.6% and 2% respectively compared to the previous quarter in 2017. Growing debt is a concern, because it means less consumer spending in the economy and more money being spent on debt obligations. Since mortgages account for the bulk of debt, It is a real concern, because the last recession was due to the housing market. Another reason this is a major concern in 2018 is because of rising interest rates that have been set by the US Federal Reserve. For instance, from the time period of December 2015 to October 2017, there were 4 interest rates hikes. It is likely that this interest rate trend continues since rates are near their historic lows. This is quite concerning from the outside looking in because as interest rates rise, it means the total debt held will be held for a longer time. This is due to the fact that when a payment is made by the borrower of the funds, more money will be paid in interest and less in principal. Or some individuals will pay down more towards their debts, but this results in less money being available for consumer staples and discretionary items. Also, since more money is going towards debt, it means that there are fewer dollars going towards retirement and savings plans. This will impact the use of government programs in the future if there is not enough capital to fund the retirement or there will be retirement. In the end, the American banks benefit from sums of debt by consumers because of the spread on interest rates. However, if consumers stop paying their loans, it could lead to a credit bubble and the next US economic collapse in 2018. I don't know if this is going to unravel very quickly. But it is close, Schiff warns. Peter Schiff, in The Impending Collapse, Everything That Can Go Wrong, Will. The impending economic collapse is hidden from most. People only see a rising stock market, not the negative underlying factors that will cause the whole system to crash. The weakening of the US dollar is just getting started, warned veteran market forecaster Peter Schiff, CEO of Euro-Pacific Capital. We have just begun a major, long-term bear market in the dollar, he said, which should cause a spike in oil prices. He thinks oil will reach $80 minus $100 a barrel in 2018. The commodity currently trades at roughly $63 a barrel. Schiff focuses on oil as just one example of the inflation that will help collapse the dollar. Will the US dollar collapse in 2018? The US currency, relative to its competitors, is not as strong as many would like to think. Amid a series of expected interest rate hikes in the Eurozone and at the Bank of England, backed by actual economic growth, currency investors should pay attention in the coming year. It's really time to start wondering, will the US dollar collapse in 2018? Consider the US dollar index's long-term prospects, as illustrated in the chart below. It will not tell you exactly when the dollar crash will happen. But, given that the index compares the US currency's performance relative to other major currencies, it offers some sobering perspective. It's no secret that, over the course of the past 3 decades or so, the US dollar has dropped by some 25%, compared to its rivals in the currency markets. And now, the dollar is about to collapse. Is the US dollar going to collapse in 2018? Whether by design, President Donald Trump claims he wants a low dollar, or by accident, the US dollar index has lost about 10% in 2017. This trend can only continue and likely accelerate in 2018. The US dollar is paying, and will continue to pay, because of the inaction over the economy in Washington. The gamblers might bet on the dollar going up, but the wise will be the ones paying attention to US dollar collapse predictions. Much of Trump's economic strategy and recovery plan hinge on the passing of his fiscal reform. However, it's too radical and may even be too unrealistic. As presented to Congress, loaded with major tax cuts for corporations and for private individuals alike, in theory it could help stimulate growth and raise the standard of living for everybody. The logic of Trump's tax reform is that the tide lifts all boats. It's another interpretation of the trickle-down economics that President Ronald Reagan made popular in his first term, 1981 to 1985. But, as that plan proved, it's really only good for a few, and it produces huge debt. It's one of the reasons that the US dollar has lost so much strength over the past 30 to 40 years. One of the big pillars of Trump's economic reform is the tax reform. It's one of the most ambitious fiscal reforms to date, bigger even than what Reagan did in the 1980s. But there are many doubts about its viability. Perhaps Trump, or more likely the Republicans in Congress, will have to revise the plan and dilute its provisions. According to rumors, there has been pressure to shave off one of the primary components of the tax bill. This is the one that would lower corporate taxes to 20%. At best, that will have to be postponed. While the US has a relatively higher corporate tax rate than many of its industrialized competitors, it also allows for more numerous and generous tax deductions. Similarly, there's the ever-present perception and suspicion that the richest Americans are still going to end up as the biggest beneficiaries of the tax reform. As political tensions rise internationally and domestically, President Trump can't seem to make a single favorable move in the eyes of Democrats, meaning he could be a sitting duck. His opponents in Congress and there's plenty of bipartisan opposition to go around will weaken the White House politically, resulting in a diluted tax bill, regardless of what else happens. The yuan. Before any discussion over the weakness of the US economy, and if you doubt that, just look at the number of small and large-sized retail chains collapsing, it's worth noting the effect of the Chinese yuan. The more international currencies there are, the more the dollar faces competition. The value of an international currency like the dollar derives not only from interest rates and pure economic strength. Like gold, there is a strong element of perception. The dollar's strength, especially since the end of World War II, has been tied to US economic strength and political stability. But it has also been tied to US military might. Now, the world seems ready to shift toward a world where the US is no longer the only hegemony on the block. After the collapse of the Soviet Empire in 1990, the United States made the mistake of believing it was the only superpower. The mistake was good at first, helping speed up the transfer of technology from the military to the civilian realm. Few remember that the internet and email were first used by the military. Raytheon Company worked on the related infrastructure and basic idea of a connected information storage and accelerate of debt rather than slow it down. Trump's plan risks pushing debt higher, well beyond the current $20 trillion. Therefore, the Federal Reserve will be unable to raise interest rates. Similarly, other governments will want to diversify their monetary reserves, accumulating currencies that are not the US dollar. China, of course, is one of these key players. The Bank of China alone holds about $1 trillion, and it has announced its intention to divest part of its US dollar reserve. It plans to do this by using gold-backed future contracts and pricing oil in yuan. After taking concrete steps to dethrone the US as the top tech power, China is closing in on the dollar. Higher interest rates will explode the market. Trump has chosen Jerome Powell to succeed Janet Yellen as chairperson of the Federal Reserve. Powell is not a fan of raising rates. He may be even less inclined than the outgoing Yellen. Should any Fed chair raise interest rates while US debt keeps growing, the US government will struggle even to pay back interest on the debt. At the current low level, the interest owed is more than $270 billion. With rates at a more normal, or historical, level, the interest alone could top $1 trillion. For various reasons, quantitative easing, QE, will therefore have to continue. American consumers, many of whom are struggling to cope with one form of debt or another, would get an increased perception of wealth with interest rates kept low. Higher rates would mean much higher interest on car loans, student loans, and mortgages. The US comes closer to recession with every interest rate hike. Higher interest hurts the ability to borrow, which could prompt a recession. Trump has enough problems to worry about without adding that one to the list. Investors built a system in the late 1960s. The apparent victory of the American system over the Soviet one eased security considerations and, by 1995, many people were using the internet. By 2000, there were few people left in the world that were not using the internet. American businesses and finance benefited tremendously from the emergence of the so-called tech sector. It became, and still remains, the main growth generator in the American economy. But how long can America's dominance last? China's closing in. Fast. China is catching up quickly in every field of technology. Meanwhile, more and more American companies have moved their manufacturing to China already. Moreover, the Chinese are also expanding their military capabilities, building their own military vessels, stealth fighter jets, and smart weapons. They're even planning a space mission to the moon. China's international influence is rising in conjunction with its technology and military capacity. Part of that growing influence includes the yuan. China's currency is growing in importance. The International Monetary Fund, IMF, recently included it as a special drawing rights currency. Therefore, many central banks around the world are buying the yuan, with central banks reported having accumulated holdings valued at over $90 billion at the end of 2016. Just 6 months later, those same central banks held just short of $100 billion. Internationally, and even in the domestic US, there is uncertainty that the yuan can continue to rise at this unexpectedly rapid pace. Apart from the shift or erosion of American influence, the United States has built up a considerable but unfortunate phenomenon, debt. US debt keeps growing larger, and Trump's aforementioned fiscal policies could accelerate the